A couple of announcements that I would like to make this morning for the good of the order. First of all, on Sunday, October 4th at 4 in the afternoon, we will have our blessing of the animals. The deacons have decided that because this is an outdoor event and because we're having our dogs and cats and goats with us, we generally space ourselves out pretty well anyway, that we will go ahead and hold this service that has come to mean so much to many of us on October 4th at 4 o'clock. Lisa asked me to let you all know that the welcome home parade that we had planned for Peg Fox today at noon will not take place. It's too cold for Peggy to stand out in the open today. So I will let you know if it gets rescheduled. Watch for announcements in the steeple or via the prayer chain. We'll let you know. I wanna begin once again this week with a few words about this worship that we continue to have. We are here present despite physical distancing. We are here, each of us in our own individual spaces and yet connected across the miles. I continue to find this separation to be difficult. I miss seeing you in our beautiful meeting house. But our Christian faith mandates that we put the needs of other people before our own needs. Eventually, we'll be back in the sanctuary together, but in the meantime, even though we continue to be physically distanced, we also continue to worship together by the grace of God and thanks to technology. Grace to you all and peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Whoever you are and wherever you find yourself physically or spiritually on the journey of faith, know that you are welcome here exactly as you are to share in the gifts of God so freely given. This ongoing season of physical distancing and difficult decisions may make it hard to feel the strands of love that connect us as community. When we gather to share stories from scripture, to pray and to listen, we are reminded that God is always reaching out to us, centering our lives, bound to us by heartstrings of love that tether us to God and to one another. Come, open your hearts. Let's worship God together.
Come and fill our hearts with your peace. You alone are holy. Come and fill our hearts with your peace. Hallelujah. Come and fill our hearts with your peace.
Good morning. I'm going to read the opening prayer. Lord God, grand architect of the universe, your design of creation is unflawed. Yet we continue to litter your creation with defects and imperfections. Show us how not to destroy, but to create, not to demean, but to uplift, not to hate, but to love, so that your creation may be made perfect once again. Amen.
Let's sing together. Join with Bonnie and Renee. Worship service when I get to talk to the kiddos, and I am going to switch my view to gallery view here. I'm hoping to see who's here with us. Hey kids, hi Telfords, how are you?
Hey, Ed.
Hello Castillos, good to see you. So today, in a little bit, we're going to read a story about Adam and Eve. And about the snake who encouraged them to eat the fruit that God told them not to eat. So they chose to follow the snake's advice, even though it was bad advice. And sometimes we choose the wrong thing, even though it might get us into trouble, right? Do you sometimes make the poor choice once in a while? Not always, right? But some of the time, choices. It's hard sometimes to know what's the right thing and what's the wrong thing, but what's important to remember is that no matter what choice we make, God chooses to love us anyway. And when we remember God's love, sometimes it's easier to make the right choices, the good choices. So I think you all have something to create this morning, and we're going to kind of keep it a secret and show it to the grown-ups at the end of our time together, okay? So go ahead and create the things that you have your little packets for, and Let's start right now with a prayer together. Pray after me. God. When we have a choice to make.
When we have a choice to make.
May we always choose. The one that shows your love. Amen.
Our reading today is from Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden. But God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Mike. That was lovely. Hi, Daddy. My father's on the screen. I have to acknowledge him there. Welcome to worship at Hampton, all the way from Chicago. Just before the movie A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood was released, I watched an interview with Tom Hanks. The acclaimed actor said that in Fred Rogers, he had met his match. His director had said, "You'll get a wig, you'll get some eyebrows, You'll get a sweater and blue deck shoes. The rest is up to you. It was not going to be an easy role to play. If you ever watched Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, you'll understand what I mean when I say that Mr. Rogers was an utterly unique character in the history of television. He was an ordained Presbyterian minister on a mission to reach, teach, and help children. He didn't shy away from difficult subjects. He was genuinely concerned about kids, and he had a knack for getting people of all ages to share their concerns with him. Rogers asked incisive questions, waited patiently, allowing silence to draw out answers. And then he listened with love instead of judgment. For Tom Hanks to become Fred Rogers, he had to delve deeply into the life of this unique individual, talking to people who had known Fred, watching the show that he had produced, and even listening to tapes of conversations that Rogers had had with his therapist. Hanks learned that Fred Rogers dictated the tempo of conversations by his practice of listening, and that his greatest potency was in the pause. In order to play the role, Hanks had to transform himself into the glacially paced Mr. Rogers, slowing down his natural responses, quieting his own impulses in order to get inside his character and become Fred Rogers on the big screen. Despite Hanks' impeccable research and his accomplishment as an actor, when I went to see the movie, I could not help but see the ways that Tom Hanks was different from Fred Rogers. Please join me for a moment of prayer. Loving God, be present with us now. Allow us all to see the ways that you are at work in our world today. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Sometimes it feels like we've lost the ability to slow down, to claim the power of the pause, to listen for what's behind life's facades. When I read the allegories of the Old Testament, creation, Noah's Ark, the Tower of Babel, I often find myself wondering why those stories were written. What exactly was the question the tale was intended to answer? Why were two separate creation stories placed in the opening chapters of Genesis? The lovely poetry of the first narrative suggests that human beings were created in the image of God, and that at the outset of creation, all was in harmony. The second story emphasizes Adam's earthly beginnings. Adam, was fashioned from the Adama, the dust of the earth. Right here at the opening of our sacred story lie two separate allegories, two unique claims about the nature of humankind. The first asserts that humans are akin to their creator, like God. The second story makes it clear that humans are unlike God, earthly and finite. Why set these two stories side by side? Maybe it's because together, the two reveal the both and of human nature. We are both like and unlike our creator, finite creatures with an infinite imagination. There's a tension between these two inherent human characteristics, a tension that's set in high relief in Eden's garden. Biting into the apple, disobeying God, opened their eyes, forever shifting the human's perception of themselves and their world. Where they had once lived in a God-centered world, Their newfound knowledge led them to believe that they lived in an anthropocentric world, a world where humans could assert themselves as the center of value, decision-making, and understanding. The knowledge gained from tasting the allegorical apple resulted in an alienation in their relationship with God and with the soil, the Adama, the earth from which they had been fashioned. We are both and creatures. Although we have the ability to know the difference between right and wrong, all too often the choices we make are harmful, damaging creation, our relationship with our Creator, and other human beings. It can seem like human beings are utterly incapable of choosing the good. Hunger, climate collapse, political unrest, power imbalances, pandemic, all the result of human choice. But today, instead of asking why this story, maybe a better question to ask is how. How are we to hold the tension between these two critical aspects of human nature? How do we strike a balance between the earthly, finite part of ourselves and that which is akin to divinity? Just as Tom Hanks sank into, was immersed in the role in or and of Fred, and immersed in the qualities of Fred Rogers in order to play the part of him on the big screen, we need to sink into, to acknowledge and understand both sides of our human nature. We are creatures of the earth, decidedly not God. We know a lot, but all too often that knowledge places human beings at the center of life, and we lose our innate sense of dependence on creation. We forget that we are finite. And we are those who are akin to God, created in God's likeness. We are both and. So I wonder, what have we learned or leaned into the work of ascertaining and imitating the characteristics of our Creator? Characteristics like generosity, forgiveness, steadfast love. What if we sank into, immersed ourselves, absorbed some of those qualities and became more like the people God intended us to be? You all know what happened after those first humans transgressed. God expelled our naked, knowledge-bearing ancestors from that garden. God promised that their journey would be painful. But there is one detail buried in the aftermath of human transgression that I have had a tendency to skip over. But this week, I think this detail is important to notice. It feels important to me today. Scripture says, "And the Lord God made garments of skin for the man and for his wife, and clothed them." This intimate detail is an essential reminder about the character of our God. God's beloved children had done the one thing they had been forbidden to do. They were expelled from paradise. But God did not leave them to suffer the consequences of their actions alone. God did not abandon the wayward human beings, those both and creatures. Instead, God covered their vulnerable bodies, wrapped them in a layer of protection as they headed out of Eden, expelled, but not abandoned. God is faithful. This week, maybe we can consider taking a cue from Fred Rogers. Practice the pause. Leave space for God to respond to you, to your questions. Embrace the creative, wise, forgiving side of your human nature. And as you do, may the God of love wrap you in loving kindness and keep you from harm. Amen.
and heaven except you. When it's time to go home and when hard times have found you, and your fear surrounds you and my love around you, you're never alone. Never alone. Never alone. I'll be in every beat of your heart when you face the unknown. Whatever you fly, whatever you fly, kissing goodbye. My love will follow you, stay with you, baby.
Thanks to Vinny for creating that video as a reminder of our times when we've worshiped together. We will return to that place that we love. May the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. I am going to have Meg open us up here so that you can all see each other and offer each other a sign of God's peace. She's going to unmute you. So name the people you see on your screen and let them know that you see them and you offer them God's peace.
My camera, my video's not working today. Hello, video's not working.
Peace, Beckers, peace be with you.
Peace, everybody.
Hi, Phyllis.
Hi. Peace, Joy.
Peace, Phyllis.
Sylvia
peace,
and Burnham, their church.
Good morning.
Daddy.
Good morning.
Hi, Phyllis.
Good apple.
Hi, Sylvia.
Fun.
Hi, Lisa. Hi, everybody in church.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Karen.
Hi, everybody.
Good morning.
That was really nice, Vinny.
Thank you. Thank
Very
you.
Nice.
Hi, Ginny's dad.
Hi, Ginny's dad.
Hi, Bill.
Some of the frames are frozen.
Hi, Ginny's dad.
Yeah. Lovely she? Video.
Oh,
yeah.
In the front.
Oh, dear.
Good morning, Michelle. She's still on mute.
Greetings, Bill. Hello, hello.
Please be with us. She's got the blank.
We are now going to move into our time of prayer, which is a little bit different today. We're not going to share our prayers in person. If you have a prayer request that you want shared, please feel free to type it into the chat box.
Do you have something that you want her to pray on? Do you want a prayer for someone?
Let us pray. Trusting in the promises of God in our midst, we pray for our communities, both in the flesh and online, and all God's world, for this uncertain time. Well, God, we particularly pray this morning for continuing healing for Phyllis, for all who mourn the loss of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, for the family of Marion Emmons, and for those whose names are now on your screens. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers and hear us now as we pray together using the words Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Meg is going to open us up again now, and hopefully some of our children have things to share with us. Can you show us what you've been making, kids? Look, look, look. Can you see that, guys? Helen, tell us what it is.
It's a snake.
It's a snake. Thomas and William, do you have snakes also? Mm-hmm. Yes. I love the colors. Look at that. Oh, Mackenzie, what you got there? Can you show us? Mackenzie?
I'm not done yet.
Oh, you're not finished. Okay, keep working on it.
You want to hold it up?
Every time we try and do this, do we have
to... We didn't give her enough time. Anybody else have a snake to show us?
Maddie will have to share hers next week when we get the camera working on the laptop.
Maddie and Mackenzie and Evie might all show us their snakes next week. Thanks, guys. Thank you. And now we're going to close... our worship by singing together again. And so last week, we began creating our heartstring. I think all of you received in the mail an envelope, something like this, and in it were pieces of fabric. And last week we tied two together. This week I invite you to tie a third piece onto your string. The goal is to, and I'm doing mine as we speak, the goal is to create a much longer string. And we will gather these up, the deacons will gather these up in the middle of November. And together we will create an image of our connections to God and each other from the long strings that we're making now. So go ahead, tie your strings together, and Mike will, and as I give the benediction and Mike plays the postlude. Friends, as you go from here, remember to love. For love is what God asks of us, and love is what binds us to God and to one another. Go from here to love and serve God by loving and serving all those you meet. And may God, who first loved us and who showed us what love looks like, be with you and abide with you as the heartstring of connection. Amen. Thank you, Mike.
Ginny, we have executive council now.
We do.